Hello and welcome to our special webinar today on Analyze 11.0. My name is Beth Adams and I'm going to be your presenter. Looks like we're waiting for just a few more people to join, so I'll wait just another minute and then we'll go ahead and get started. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started then. So, as usual, our webinar today is going to last for around 30 minutes. And what I'll be covering today is I'll be providing you with information about the Analyze 11.0 release. And then I will demonstrate a select number of the new features and enhancements that are going to be available. And then I'll end with some information about how to upgrade or purchase Analyze 11.0. And then I'll open it up for questions about the new version. So just a few notes quickly. If you have questions throughout the webinar, feel free to enter them into the questions panel of the GoToWebinar control panel. Michael Philcock is on the line and he will be answering questions throughout the webinar, but like I said, I'll also open it up at the end for questions too. Also after the webinar, tomorrow you'll receive an email with a link to where you can watch a recording. And you'll also receive a link to our website where you can view a copy of this presentation. And that link is going to be analyzedirect.com/webinars. The recording will also be posted on our YouTube channel as well at www.youtube.com/analyzedirect. So Analyze 11.0 is the latest version of the Analyze software suite. It'll be released commercially on May 31st, 2012, and you can find complete details of the release as well as a detailed new features and enhancements document on our website at analyzedirect.com/analyze11. A few of the highlights of this new version are going to include a new image repair module with tools for repairing corrupt regions, improved DICOM anonymization options, as well as improved export support, and also database filtering options. You're also going to find improved rendering controls in the Volume Render module, additional segmentation tools and options in Volume Edit, and then the ability to do a fully fine registration in the 3D voxel registration module. There are over 50 new features and enhancements in Analyze 11.0, though, so I'd encourage you to go to our website for that full list. So I'm going to go ahead and jump right into our demonstration of some of these new features and enhancements. So I'll begin with the DICOM tool. Within the DICOM tool, I mentioned earlier that you do have some new options for anonymization. Previously, you were only able to anonymize patient information. In Analyze 11.0, though, you'll now find that you can also anonymize study and series information. So if I right-click on a data set here and choose Anonymize Patient, you can see that I also get these study panes as well as series. So we can edit all of that information as well. Further, you can add additional DICOM tags. So if there are fields not listed here that you want to anonymize, you can add those DICOM tags and anonymize those. So for instance, if you wanted to remove the study date, you would just add the DICOM field for study date, and then that could be changed. Very useful if you're doing blinded studies and need to remove this information. Another new option in the DICOM tool is the ability to filter which data sets are displayed in this window based on their date of import. So I don't know if you're like me, but oftentimes I get a large number of data sets in my database and I import a new one and I can't figure out where it's located. So one way you can address that is if you right-click and choose Configure Search. This Configure Search window now has this Date of Import option. If you click in this field, this calendar will pop up and you can choose to filter just files that were imported on a specific date. Or you can also choose anything that was imported before a specific date, after, or between dates. I'm just going to choose to look at data sets that were imported today. So I choose April 19th, click OK, and then choose Search. And now you can see only those two data sets that I imported today. To get back to the regular view, you just hit clear, and we can see everything once again. So an additional feature that's been added to the DICOM tool that may not be immediately apparent is the maintenance of spatial location information for slices. So if I exit the DICOM tool and I go into my workspace here, and I look at the header information for a DICOM dataset that I've imported, you'll see that now it's going to track the spatial location of each slice in the entire series. And where this will be useful is if you output this same data set out of Analyze in DICOM format, you're going to see improved compatibility with other softwares. So I'm going to go ahead now and move into the volume render module and show you some of the new features that have been added there. So go ahead and open volume render. I'm just going to open my preview window quickly so you can see as I make changes. So the first thing you'll notice in the Analyze 11.0 volume render is the render type window. The render type window now gives you immediate access to the other major rendering options underneath the generate menu, as well as the render type specific options. So these type specific options are the options that are specific to this render type selected over here. So if you see, if you click the threshold button here, for instance, the threshold window will pop right up. I'm going to go ahead and just threshold down to the skin and hit render. Another new option that you'll find in Analyze 11.0 is that you can actually rotate directly from the preview window. So you can see I can just drag and drop here and move my rendering around quickly. You can still, of course, get quick access to the original rotation window, though, directly from the render type window. So I hit rotation, and I can reset back to my original view. Volume render is also going to include some new options for creating visually enhanced renderings, and this is going to be with the volume compositing render type. So that you can get a good idea of what these enhanced renderings are going to look like, I'm going to go ahead and load a tissue map. So you can see now we have our volume compositing type specific tissue map option here. So I just click that. And I'm going to load a tissue map that I created earlier. And hit render. And one of the first ways in which you can create these visually enhanced renderings is with the background color. So I'm going to click the background option here. I'm going to change our background color to white. And you can see with the white background, my other tissue in my tissue map, which was a tissue related to the skin, actually shows up quite nicely. And then Analyze 11.0, the reason why it looks so nice is because the background color is actually composited directly into the rendering. The next option that you have for creating visually enhanced renderings is going to be called super sampling. With super sampling, what happens is a ray is cast through every pixel in the rendering. And this creates basically a higher resolution or high definition rendering. Now this is going to take a little bit longer to render, so I'm going to just close out my preview window before I activate this. And to get access to super sampling, you first need to turn on interpolated rays. And now right now we have to use kind of a tricky quick key to activate this. In the final version of Analyze 11.0 that we release on May 31st, this will be easier to access though. So I'm going to press Control Alt Shift S. And now you can see I do have this super sample checkbox. So I check super sample. And you can see I can choose to oversample by 2, 3, or 4 rays. And I'm going to choose 2 and hit render. And you can see now we do have this really nice high resolution rendering. And this can of course always be saved out by going to File, Save Renderings. So that's all I'm going to demonstrate in Volume Render today. We do have some additional new features here, so I would encourage you to take a look at that detailed new features and enhancements document on the website. Next, I'm going to show you the new image repair module. This is available underneath the process menu. And what it allows you to do is allows you to correct corrupt regions or corrupt slices within a data set. So within this data set, we have a few corrupt slices. I'll just move to those quickly. So you can see here, we have a break there. So if I wanted to correct this, I would need to specify which slices are bad. So I can actually go ahead and just type that in here. And then we have the option to correct these slices just using adjacent slices, or we can try to correct just a subregion of the slice. And to do that, we select this bad region checkbox, and we can now set a subregion around the corrupt area. And what will happen is this subregion is going to be corrected based on the correction method selected down here. We can either choose to copy from the closest good slice, or we can interpolate between the first good slices. So what that will do is it will interpolate using the information from the slices on either side of these bad slices. With the bad region, the corrected voxels will be blended out into the surrounding data within this blend border. So I'll go ahead and just choose to repair slices now and change a copy. You can already see the corrected preview here, so you can see the dramatic difference. So this is, it's kind of a basic module, but it can be very powerful and very useful. So I'll go ahead and exit that. You can see my corrected data set now here in the workspace. Next, I'm going to move into the Volume Edit module. For those of you who are not aware, Volume Edit is a new module that was added in Analyze 10.0, and it's continuing to evolve. We're really finding a lot of great new uses for it. It can really streamline your segmentation tasks. And Analyze 11.0 just continues on that evolution, and we've added some really useful new features here. The first of which is going to be underneath this Edge Strength tab. So if you check Use Edge Strength, it's going to calculate the edges there. And in Analyze 10.0, the way that you viewed edges was just by pressing down this Edge Strength threshold button. And what you would get is you'd get a binary display here. You can already see immediately that we have those red outlines now in place of the binary image. However, you can also check this Show Edges option. And this will actually show you the edges continually. And this becomes useful because you can now actually move through your slices and review the edges and make sure that you have your settings set appropriately. So once you've selected your edge threshold, you just uncheck Show Edges, and you can move on into your Walls tab. And this is actually where we're going to see our next new feature. So I'll check to define walls to limit semi-automated operations. And the new feature here is going to be a spline wall type. So if I choose Draw Wall, and I am actually going to go ahead and define a wall between the left ventricle and the left atrium. So I'll move through my slices here. And if I choose this spline option, what I can do is I can just draw in my spline, and I just click to set the spline control points. And once you double click, you can actually go back and you can move those spline points. If you click on them with your middle mouse button, you can drag and drop those. Once you're satisfied with your spline, you just click Apply, and it's now been set as a wall. Now, another capability that you have with walls, this is actually available in Analyze 10.0, but a lot of people don't know about it, so I did want to go ahead and demonstrate it today. And what happens is if you define a wall on another slice in the same orientation, it'll actually interpolate between the wall on the first slice and the second slice. So I'm going to define a second spline here. And I forgot to mention earlier, we do also have this smart edge option for the spline. And the smart edge will do kind of like an edge detection, so it can, again, further refine and enhance that wall. But I'll click apply. And you can see now if I move back through my slices, you can see this is actually interpolating between that first wall I set and the second one. Now that I have my walls defined, I'll go ahead and move into my semi-automatic tab. We don't really have any new features in the semi-automatic tab, but in order for me to show you what's new in the manual tab, I'm just going to define some new regions quickly. I'm going to use the object extractor, and then I'll just go ahead and define an object for the left atrium to start. So I'm going to click to set a seed point, and then set a threshold range. Click Extract Object. Now that is extracted, I will go ahead and lock that. And then I'll add another object. And this object is going to be for the purpose of showing some of our manual tools. So it may not make sense quite yet. And then I'll click Define Object. So we'll move into the manual tool now, and I'm going to go ahead and lock that green object 3 and add a new object. I'm going to define a new object using the new draw tool. So this new draw tool acts kind of like a paintbrush. You can change the size, the shape of the tool. You use a circle, square, or diamond. You can also change the size of the pen, so we can make that larger. And now that I have my object 3 and my object 2 locked, what I could do is I could define a region by just roughly painting over it, and it won't leak out into anything that belongs to the green or red object. I'm going to be a little rough here and just paint over quickly. And as soon as I release my mouse button, you can see that's been defined as an object. And I can move to my next slice just using my scroll wheel on my mouse. I'm just doing this very roughly, obviously. You can see this can make certain types of segmentation a lot faster. The draw tool can also be used to define regions directly on the rendering. So if I were to go ahead and turn off that green object, I'm going to unlock red object and add another new object, and then come over to my rendering. And you can see if I paint over my rendering with my draw tool, you can see those voxels were immediately changed, and that was cut all the way through. Another new option that you're going to find in Volume Edit is in the right-click menu here for the rendering. If you right-click, you can choose to reset rotation, and now you can choose to reset to the front, back, left, right, top, or bottom. And it'll go immediately to that standard position. So that concludes what I'll be showing you in Volume Edit today. Again, there are additional new features here that I'm not showing, so I'd encourage you to go to the website and take a look at that detailed document. So go ahead and exit Volume Edit. And now I'm going to show you some of the new options for multi-volumes and retaining volume names. So I'm going to move into my other workspace. And in this workspace, I have several different DTI maps. I'm going to go ahead and append these as a 4D multi-volume. So I'm just going to select each map, holding my control key, and I'll choose Append. And I'll select to create a multi-volume with 4 volumes. And I'll unload after the successful append. And you can see it's created that 4D multi-volume now. And I'm going to take this into the region of interest module, because what I want to show you is that in the region of interest module, when you sample this 4D multi-volume, it'll actually report the names of the individual 3D 3D volumes, excuse me. So I'm going to load an object map quickly that I've already defined. Let's see if I move through my slices. You can see those regions there. Also, you notice we now had this volume slider. So you can move through the different volumes in your 4D multi-volume directly from this main interface. Now if I go to my sample options window, I'm just going to quickly specify my sampling parameters. And I'll turn log stats to on so that we get the log file at the end. Hit sample images. And you can see now in my ROI stat log, we have the original name of each one of those DTI maps. So this is going to make it a lot easier to track, you know, which measurements are associated with which volume. So I'll go ahead and exit out of that. And then another option that you have related to multi-volumes is going to be to unappend and retain the original volume names. So if I right-click on my appended files and choose unappend, I'll choose don't unload. Oh, and so it looks like this didn't work quite the way I intended to. Typically what should happen here is that it should retain the original volume names. Let me try this with the original file I had. Yes, so with this original file I created, I selected don't unload, and this time it did ask me if I wanted to use the original volume names. So click yes. And you can see those original volume names were retained. So that's going to conclude the demonstration for today. Like I said, there are a number of additional new features that we're not showing, and you can view those all on the website. So in conclusion, the release date, again, for Analyze 11.0 is going to be May 31st, 2012. Regarding upgrading, customers who have purchased an Analyze 10.0 license since March 1st will receive a free upgrade to Analyze 11.0. Also, customers who have an active maintenance agreement on the date of the release will also be eligible for a free upgrade. Outside of that, customers who have an Analyze 10.0 license without a maintenance agreement do still have the opportunity to purchase a maintenance agreement until May 30th. Also, customers who are running older versions of Analyze can purchase a special upgrade and maintenance agreement package that we're offering at a discounted price. Just to, you know, outside of the new features and enhancements that we've looked at today, some additional benefits of using the latest version of Analyze include the fact that you'll continue to get the most up-to-date support for the DICOM standard and other image formats. The DICOM standard is continually evolving, and so we're always, you know, releasing patch updates to support new image types and new fields. And also, when you're running the latest version, you'll continue to receive additional updates throughout the life of the version through patches. So I'm going to go ahead and open it up to questions at this point. Let me see what we have here. So the first question that I'm seeing is a question about object map support in the line profile module. So I hadn't mentioned this earlier, but this is a new feature, is that you can actually load object maps into the line profile module. Let me step back to my main workspace and I'll show you how you could do this quickly. I'll just use this MRI 3D head and open line profile. So this automatically loaded my object map. This is another new feature that Analyze 11 happens to include, is auto-loading of object maps. You can control this from the other menu in the main Analyze window. If you go to Other Options, you can see here you can choose whether you want object maps to be auto-loaded or if you want the module to prompt you to load it. And you can also control the auto-creation of object maps. But moving back into line profile, you can see that this object map has been loaded. And really what the purpose of this is so that you can use your object map as a visual guide when drawing your line profiles. So you can, you know, use those object boundaries to help guide you. The lines won't be restricted to your objects though. Okay, the next question I'm seeing here is about the histogram display in the intensity window. This is another new feature, again, I didn't mention, but it is outlined in that new features and enhancements document. The intensity window that we're referring to here is going to be underneath View Intensities. And what the new feature is it's this histogram option. If you check this, you automatically get a histogram of the intensity values in the volume. And you can, you know, control the magnitude of that histogram using this side slider. And what this is useful for is determining how to set, you know, your windowing here. And you can also use it, you know, at any point when you need to set a threshold. You can come in here and reference this to help aid with determining where to set that threshold. And this option is going to be available in all of your Analyze modules where you just go to View Intensities. And then you'll be able to check this histogram checkbox. And that did come out of a user request. So it's one thing we always encourage people to send us the requests when they have them, because you never know when it's going to be added as a new feature. So some additional questions I'm seeing here. With regards to the image repair module, why use the bad region option? Why wouldn't I correct the entire slice? This is really going to depend on the situation, you know, the nature of the corrupt regions that you have. I'll go ahead and step back out of here, and I'll open up that image repair quickly. You know, so it may not always be appropriate to correct the entire slice. You may have a very small region that you want to correct, and you don't want to overwrite all of the good regions outside of that. And that's when you would use this bad region option to do the correction. Next question I have here is image edit. Volume edit. Can you define walls in multiple orientations or just a single orientation? This is referencing, if I go back into my volume edit module, this is referencing this walls tab. And the question is, can you only define walls in one orientation, or you can define in all three orientations? And you can actually define walls in all three orientations. So for instance, I could draw a wall here in my transverse orientation, and then I could also come down and draw a wall in my coronal orientation. And then another question is, can you define more than two walls in the same orientation? Yes and no. So you cannot define two walls on the same slice in one orientation. So I could not define one wall here. I could not go and define another wall on this same slice. You would have to move to another slice and then define your next wall. Okay, I think that's all the questions we have time for today. If any of the questions did not get answered, we will follow up with you after the webinar and address those via email. So in conclusion, make sure to watch for an email from Analyze Webinars tomorrow. That'll have the link to where you can find the recording of the webinar as well as a copy of this presentation. Also, make sure to check out the Analyze 11.0 release page at analyzedirect.com/analyze11. If you have ideas for future webinars, please feel free to email those to us at webinars@analyzedirect.com. And if there are any additional questions that you have, feel free to contact me directly at any time. You can email me at beth@analyzedirect.com, or you can call me on my direct line at 913-653-8306. Thank you, everyone, for attending today. I hope that you are as excited about Analyze 11.0 as we are.